All right, we're going to get started. Thank you so much for joining us today at lunch for lunch. And I want to begin by saying that this is a year-long series that's meant to mark the 20th anniversary of the German Law Journal. The series is being referred to as German Law Past, Present, and Future. We're going to start in the past. Although we're going to hear today from Professor Ambos that maybe the past is never quite beyond us. And I want to just remind you that we'll be marking that anniversary with these events, one in January and then again in the spring. So keep an eye out and please plan on joining us for those. As I said, we'll start with the past in German law a bit, a glimpse into the past. But it's clear that that it has quite a lot of resonance, and there are echoes of the past in German law for contemporary justice and contemporary criminal law institutions. And I don't think I have to say much more than to say that the shadow of the past is not a uniquely German problem with respect to criminal law issues. And I'll leave it at that. Before I turn the podium over to my cherished colleague, Nora Demleitner, who will introduce Professor Ambos, let me just say a couple of things about the German Law Journal before I surrender my privileged time here at the podium. This is the 20th year of the German Law Journal's successful run as one of the world's leading platforms for the publication of scholarship on law from a transnational or comparative law perspective. And that means publication on scholarship concerned with German law written by outsiders to that legal tradition in that community, but also comparative and international law work focused on European legal developments and international law as well. I'm pleased to say that this journal has grown to remarkable success. I can say that not only because one of the first authors to publish in the German Law Journal was Professor Ambos, and it took I have to say, a little bit of courage from established scholars like him at the beginning of this project to give it credibility and launch it in the landscape. It's now a world leader in impact factor as measured by both our esteemed W&L Law Journal rankings, but also by the Google Impact Factor scoring. And just as prominently, it pioneered the model for open access, free online publication of scholarly research that will become the standard for research in the world. That lured Cambridge University Press into a collaboration with us. So we're looking forward to a really exciting next 20 years. This success, I have to end by noting, is largely to be credited to the W&L students, your classmates, the current generation and past generations who have worked exhaustively on this project, editing it and managing it. I want to take this chance just to say how grateful I am to their contribution. With that, I'll ask Nora to come up and introduce our guest, and we look forward to it. Wow, thanks so much.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. I really want to be the first one to congratulate Professor Miller, all of you, and the German Law Journal on 20 years. And I have to say, I think so much of it is really due to his foresight to understand that online publications will be the future, and really that open access should be the future. We're still working on that, I think, collectively. But I think that's where we're all headed for the greater good, really, of the scholarly enterprise. I think the other really important component is that he managed to not only solicit pieces directly about German law, but pieces that have kind of really repercussions and thinking well beyond that. And Professor Ambos's talk today really falls very squarely into that framework. As Professor Miller said, he will reach back into German history, but really talk about what this means for the presence of German law, and beyond that, for the presence of law in Latin American countries. And I would argue we should talk and think a little bit about what this means for current American criminal law. There's always been an interesting kind of confluence of thinking between the two countries, even though I think both of them would say directly there's no influence at all. Now, I want to introduce Professor Ambos, but I also know that he is eager to get going. I know you all can do research. He has a Wikipedia page, so that should tell you already how important he is. He holds a full chair professorship at the University of Göttingen and teaches there international criminal law, criminal procedure, and comparative law. As you can tell, in addition to his academic work, he is also a judge on the Special Tribunal for the Kosovo, which sits in The Hague. Now, I met Professor Ambos for the first time actually at the Max Planck Institute for International and Comparative Criminal Law in Freiburg. And at the time, he was about to finish a book on drug control policies in Colombia, Peru, and Bolivia. And those countries and Latin America in general remains very close to his heart. Now, Professor Ambos has written widely on international criminal law, but he also participated, for example, as defense counsel in a very important case before the Yugoslavia Tribunal. Now, personally, I have watched him be a very fierce advocate for the accused when he visited as a German judge a German prison, and I think put a little bit of the fear of God into the warden at the time. Now, his current book, and thanks to Amazon.de, I got the German version of it, not to show off. It is my first language, so it is a lot easier for me. This book really grew out of what was supposed to be, I believe, a short book review of a Latin American scholar's review of German or of Nazi criminal law. But it ultimately grew into a book of this size where he really not only critiqued that scholar, but really presented his own analysis of how Nazi criminal law was a continuation from the past, but kind of continues today. I think the other noteworthy part about all of this is, and I find this stunning every time I see it, how many of the leading Nazi academics continued or were reappointed to chair professorships at leading German universities after the war. Of course, disavowing their earlier beliefs, but truly probably continuing some of that thinking. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to Professor Ambos, but please collect your questions, and I suspect you'll have tons of them for him. So thank you.
So thank you. So thanks to Russ and Nora, and it's a great pleasure for me to be here first time, never visited this state. But let us not lose time, because the time is very short. I was told at 1 o'clock everybody leaves here. And I do not want to talk so much. I could talk for hours, for days, but it wouldn't make sense. Rather, we could enter into a conversation. So feel free to ask me questions at any time and interrupt. So there is an English version of this book here on the right. The cover will be blue. We just changed it yesterday. But it will be an English version, extended version. So for those of you who have not the privilege to have first mother tongue German like Nora, can read it in English. There are a lot of footnotes, heavy footnotes. Maybe Maura has realized that's my style of writing, maybe of German's writing, you know, 2/3 of a page footnotes and the rest text. But it is necessary in this case because I worked very closely with primary sources, and that means the writings of German scholars in criminal law, especially between 33 or let's say even 28 to 45. And so you have to quote and to really demonstrate that the argument in the text is supported by the source. And what we decided was to have the German official original text in the footnotes, which is not very common, but we wanted to give American, English, Canadian, whatever readers a possibility to look at the German original, because of course we translated then from the German original source into English. But it's if you work in different languages, you know that's always tricky, you know. And so it's good for people who know German that they can look at the original German source. Sometimes words matter very much, especially in law. The basic thing what we can discuss here is really a condensed version of the research and of the book, and these are the sections like we could cover. First of all, what is actually National Socialist criminal law in a nutshell? It is criminal law made by Nazis. Of course, Nazis, but in this sense, ideologically Nazis, speaking of people who are convinced by the National Socialist ideology and people who have had prominent places in Nazi legal policy. One person who perhaps know, Rudolf Freisler, you know, the famous judge who was also later the judge at the Volksgerichtshof when Stauffenberg and the others who made the failed attempt to kill Hitler, 20th of July 44, were executed. A few days before the end of the war, and Freisler, there is a film about this, the original source shouting at the accused, you know, and that showed his disdain for the accused and for fair trial. So Freisler is a kind of figure, a prominent figure for Nazi criminal law. Freisler actually was a very smart guy. He had very good exams for the Germans. If there are Germans in the room, he had zweistellige exam, you know, he had 12 points in the first state exam and about 14 in the second. So, and all these people are very smart. You shouldn't underestimate them, especially the scholars who supported Nazi thinking. You have very, very prominent scholars, and for example, in constitutional law, of course, Carl Schmitt, who was a great antipode to Kelsen, and Kelsen, as you know, had to leave, he went to the United States. He never got a job in the United States. It's a very tragic story, the most famous constitutional lawyer maybe of the 20th century. And Carl Schmitt was, of course, and still is, a very important scholar. I mean, we're just discussing a successor on a chair in Göttingen, and we have a Carl Schmitt Society, and some of our constitutional lawyers are in the society, which is quite interesting because Carl Schmitt certainly is a person who has writings which are clearly National Socialist, and he, for example, wrote a famous paper I quote in the book, Der Führer ist das Recht, you know, the leader is the law, the leader sets the law, and you have to follow the leader. And the other two authors, just to talk about constitutional law, the trias of Nazi constitutional law is Forsthoff, and for those who know German, Verfassungsgeschichte der Neuzeit is an important book in constitutional history, which I had to use when I started to study law in 84 in Freiburg. And the professors didn't tell us that this author is actually a Nazi author. The book was still on the market. It was widely read. It was a major book to understand constitutional legal history in German law faculties. And Forsthoff wrote a book, which I quote also in my book, is the total Nazi state. So it was a major book to lay the foundation of the National Socialist state. And the third author is Ernst Rudolf Huber, who was the father of the later president of the German Protestant Church. We have this Evangelische Kirche Deutschland, you know, this association, and the president of this association at some time was a son of Huber, and the other child was Barbara Huber, you have met at the Max Planck. So she was actually the daughter of Ernst Rudolf Huber, you know. So there are some connections, networks, you know, in Germany. I don't say that. Just this is information. You draw your conclusions, but all of us have, in a way, a Nazi past. I mean, that's of course true of my family too, who was not in the NSDAP. I mean, everybody was at a certain stage. My grandfather was member of the NSDAP. So the interesting point is to ask, what did these people do between 33 and 45, and especially the scholars? Now, that is a question interesting for you as scholars or future scholars or lawyers. How would you deal with a situation when totalitarianism, dictatorship, authoritarian rule comes upon you in your nation, in your state, be it a state like Virginia or the Federation, United States? What would be your reaction? Would you retire? Would you go into exile? One solution. Would you just work on maybe the Bible, you know, forget law, you know, or you just side with a new movement? And that was a kind of spirit of the 30s, Weimar Republic, a kind of failed situation, failed state for many, Treaty of Versailles, and many of those younger scholars were very much also fascinated by this movement. So if you read these writings in the 30s, you see there was a kind of hope, you know, that is this new movement and this you have all these texts, the new German law, the new German criminal law, you know, it was this kind of movement. And you had, in terms of scholarship, that would be the third part here, you had two lines of thinking. Yes, but before you come to that, just very quickly, I have here all these covers of the book. This will be in the English version, also more documented. Just to give you an idea, this is just a selection, but there have been major texts, 504, which we need to understand what is the German criminal law, the German National Socialist criminal law. And this, for example, is a very important text, which was also used by Wittmann in his book, Yale Professor Wittmann, on American racist legislation and the influence on Nazi Germany, published by Princeton University Press. I have it later here if we have time. Because this was a commission which was set up by the Reichsminister of Justice, Mr. Gürtner, to reform the criminal law. So they wanted to do, the Nazis, of course, wanted to have a full new criminal law. They wanted to reform the German criminal code, which is of 1870. And they never succeeded in doing this. So the German criminal law was never fully reformed. You never had a new criminal code, you know, a full criminal code, like kind of model penal code approach. And then they went to do special laws, a lot of special laws like the Nuremberg laws, all these terrible laws. But the Gürtner Commission has a lot of material. There are two volumes on the general part, on general issues, and on the special part. And there are proceedings to this commission which have been published in the 60s, 70s by legal historians and by De Gruyter, by the publisher, in various volumes. And these proceedings document the proceedings, you know, so you can see who was saying what at a certain meeting. And there were two meetings which were very important on the influence on US law. And these are the meetings. Wittmann is actually quoting. Wittmann reads German perfectly, and he quotes then from these meetings and to make his point that America had something to teach the Nazis, you know, in a nutshell. Maybe we have time to come back to this, but the Wittmann book you should definitely read. It's a great book. It's very well written, of course, and it has received a New York Review of Books and has many great reviews, and it was published then in German by Beck, which is a bit ironic twist, but anyway, we can talk about this if you have time. There's so many things to talk about. I could talk anecdotally about many things. But the point here is that this is a very important document. So from a legal historical point, if you do legal history, you must work with the sources. So that means if you work on French law, you need French, of course. You know, if you work on German law, you need German. And that's, of course, a problem of comparative law in the United States, no? That people don't know language. In common law countries, you know, to be very blunt, I'm sorry, I'm German. Forgive me. You know this German mentality. He's not German, but half German. So anyway, yes. So, but I mean, that's true. You cannot do comparative law, except you compare Texas and Virginia, which is a bit boring, I think. Maybe not, but for me. So if you compare really different jurisdictions, you need languages. And Wittmann does this, of course, looking at these sources. And therefore, this is a very important document, because we have not all the sources, we have not all the documents. You know, there is a lot of oral history, you know, you have witnesses maybe, people who later talked in the Nuremberg trial said something in the witness stand about this, what happened or what not happened. So how do we know? And so it's good to have this documentary evidence. Of course, we have the Americans who came. I just got a document interestingly, by a family member of Alec Wallen, who was Rothschild. He was a guy who actually, one of these many, many people who, being Jew, had to leave Germany and then was a German lawyer, went to the United States, studied law, came back when the Allies won the war, were back and looked at the German Nazi law and did analysis, knowing German, of course. And so you have these documents which are not even public documents. This document I got from via Alec Wallen, professor at Rutgers, they were given to me by as a private document, still not in the public domain. And so this is very important historical material, what we have to look at if we want to know. So what is German Nazi criminal law in a nutshell? Just to go over all this, reason of time, you have this as a printout, and anyway, if not, you could send it around if someone wants to look at it before the book comes out. Basically, we have three elements of Nazi criminal law: Volk, Führer, and Party, okay? The Volk understood as a ethnically homogeneous plot-based community, Aryan community, and the Führer, of course, as Adolf Hitler, the Führer, and this entails the Führer principle, the Führer state, and the judges are enforcers of the Führer state. A very important role of judges, not separation of powers, but one has to be very, very sensible with this. If a German governor recently said, when a judge appeals court in Brandenburg decided that some people in pretrial detention have to be let out because they were too much time, the governor said, how is this possible? And so all these lawyers came and the German Association of Judges, come on, I mean, you don't have to say us anything. This separation of powers, you know, that's like, you know this. You have a president who says these things, you know. Terrible federal judge, you know. That's a no-go for anybody who lives in a constitutional state. I mean, you have separation of powers. How can a president, a politician, say something about judges? A judge is a judge. So judge decides, you don't like it, perhaps, but then perhaps try to change judges if you have a possibility. But don't tell judges what to do. You know, that's the idea of having judges, is that you don't get any comments from politicians, you know, who don't even read the judgments, you know. That's like in my country the same. They don't read it, they don't like it, and say, well, that's terrible. And so this was clearly in the Nazi state idea, that the judge was absolutely bound by the idea of the Führer. The judge was considered the enforcer of the ideas of the Führer. So the idea of legality for the Nazis only had a meaning in the sense of Nazi legality. So the you know, this idea of the binding order of the Führer. We had a big debate post-45 if this was binding. I mean, the Führer says something, gets out a degree, executive degree, signs something, a memorandum, and this is something binding. Yes, because the word of the Führer binds you. Talk about military, since we are in Lexington, you know. The German army made an oath on the Führer. That was highly, highly strategic from Hitler's. Hitler was a very smart guy in this sense, because you don't make an oath on the nation, the United States of America, Germany, but on the president, on the Führer. So all these soldiers then in Stalingrad thinking, could we actually rebel against the Führer? They had a big problem, because it's not just that Prussian soldiers don't rebel. There was this one Manstein quote, you know, General Manstein, but it was also because they said, well, we made a personal oath on Mr. Hitler. So can we actually rebel against? And so this was a new thing, and this showed this personalization, you know, of leadership and the Führer, and you are the enforcer of the ideas of the Führer. And then the party, of course, the party was not just a party. That's very important to understand. As in any totalitarian system, the party is a movement. The Nazis had two ways to get control of the state and society. One way is to undermine every existing institution. For example, this university. Take out Mr. Miller. He's too liberal. First, Nora Dempleiter, out. Don't need even to be Jewish or black or something. You just take them out because they don't like you. That's enough. You are not Nazis, so you are taken out. So you undermine the institution. That happened in Göttingen. Göttingen was highly Nazi. Kiel School, you know. Some universities, you can document it. This is now written. We have historians working on this. And the other thing is, if you cannot get rid of an institution, like the Academy of Sciences, you create your own institution. You call it the Akademie für Deutsches Recht. That was one of these institutions, the Academy for German Law, a Nazi academy, you know. Or you create, like the Hitler Youth, you create the students, Nazi students, you know, the Students Association of the Nazis. So these are the two ways to get control. So the movement is a movement which embraces the whole society and the state and tries to get control of everything, and from the bottom up to the hierarchy, to the leadership. So you have a total state with a total criminal law, in one sentence, anti-liberal, anti-positivist, substantive justification of the law, charged with völkisch ethicizing ideals and based upon the healthy sentiment of the people. And healthy sentiment of the people, gesundes Volksempfinden, is not democratic. Don't get it wrong, because some people say, well, it's nice, healthy sentiment, we have this realist in legal theory, he say, look at the people, what they think. But it was not that they went around and said, well, what do you think, you the people? No, that's you are mediating. The Führer is a mediator of this healthy sentiment. So it's actually you should think what the Führer thinks, or the Führer tells you what to think. You know, it's not a democratic thing, because you could say, of course, you can have a democratic element. You make a referendum on the death penalty, and then in many states you will get it, and that's a democratic problem, because if people Brexit, you know, I mean, what can you do? They have decided if it's only for two votes, but you don't like it, but that's democracy. Then we should rethink it. Maybe we should educate people before they vote and do this Platonian policy thing, you know, you better don't let them vote before they know the alphabet or something, you know, sorry. No, but I mean, that's democracy. But this was not about democracy. It was just using concepts which are filled with Nazi ideas and which can always be used against the enemies of the Nazis, you know. So that's very important. Now, in the book, what I do is, in the research, I basically look at the text by relevant authors without judging them. It's not just, I just present the text, I analyze the text, but I don't personally judge the authors, so you can judge them, you can look at the text, and then you can draw your own conclusions. And the continuity thesis or radicalization thesis basically says, There was a Weimar, if you want, or even 19th century continuity, Nazi criminal law, neither came out of nowhere. It was in a German tradition of authoritarian law. There were always thinkers like Binding, for example, norm theories, which were authoritarian thinkers. It was not liberal. There was, of course, a strand of liberal thinkers, but this was by no means a dominant, not all were touched by the Enlightenment, the French Revolution. And so you had a certain authoritarianism in the law, which was then radicalized by the Nazis. And then with a view to the future, you have a situation where you can say Nazi criminal did not disappear completely. So that's maybe one lesson. The Americans should have known it, that you cannot de-whatever. Nazify or debath. The Iraq thing is another experience. If you do that, you never get the people in your field. I mean, you can make a denazification, but how can you control the minds of the people? You cannot control the minds of the people, and you can, of course, not renounce on the support, and they didn't, in fact. You know that you have a very important book by Kim Primble, a historian, on the geopolitical shift in Washington then, when you had the realists saying, well, we need the Nazis against the communists, and you had this more rule of law people who actually were responsible for Nuremberg, and say we can't let them go with it. We have to do justice. But that's certainly a lesson from this, that there are these geopolitical interests which then may come and which may displace your legal interests, you know, your more idealistic interests. But also in terms of how to control a society, you have networks in a society. In the 50s of Germany was a full-fledged Nazi society. You clearly could not speak on the Nazis openly. There were too many Nazis around. It's like if I stood here in 50 in a German university, this classroom would be full of people coming out of the Second World War, soldiers, for example, or others, and many of them would still believe in the Nazi ideology, and that they were defeated. They were just defeated. I mean, it was bad luck. And the professors in the scholarship community have still been there. Of course, there were professors who could not go back, but very few, like Siegert from Göttingen. Siegert was a kind of purging professor who purged the Göttingen law faculty. He was put in by the Nazis to get rid of all non-Nazis. He was not a great scholar. And he was in the denazification by the Americans basically vetoed. But you know, the denazification had 4 degrees. This is well researched by legal historians like a colleague from Göttingen, Eva Schumann. And only if you get to a certain high level, in a certain high level category, you could not return to German universities. But many of these people returned. Georg Dahm, you know, certainly Russ knows him. He's a public international law later. Dahm Wolfram, you know, the Völkerrechts book, which was, Georg Dahm was a full Nazi. I could give you all the quotes. Schaffstein from Göttingen, who had an important book on juvenile criminal justice, which was continued by Boyke, criminal law professor, and is now continued by Satzker from München. So you have, of course, this denazification in terms of the scholars and in terms of universities was not an effective method to stop, to block universities, to Nazis return to universities, you know. And that is one issue. And that meant that and there was a silence, and then it was very difficult for you to do research on this. You have stories of very important German scholars like Roxin, Klaus Roxin, and the important scholar who wrote the first work on the Nazi crimes, Herbert Jäger, criminologist from Hamburg, a book on macro-criminality. Both have been students of Heinrich Henkel, who was a scholar who did some work on procedure and wrote some two papers, very much Nazi papers. And they asked him, and this is documented by an interview of Jäger, who is dead now, but in an interview he gave, they asked Henkel, Roxin said, I want to work on the Eichmann case, you know. You know, Eichmann was abducted by the Mossad from Buenos Aires, brought to Jerusalem, and Eichmann was a very important person. And then Henkel said, well, I don't recommend you to do this. If you want to make a career, you know, you better don't touch these topics, you know. That was in the 50s, 60s. And the same happened with Jäger, who then wrote this important book. And both did it, and then Henkel was, and that was the positive thing, Henkel supported them when they decided against his advice to do it. But it was, the climate was, better don't talk about these things, you know. You better do some dogmatic, you know, some topics which are less politically delicate, you know. And that was the situation in the 50s, 60s. So you clearly had this continuity which existed a long time, and we could go on. Now, then the issue of the scholarship, you know, these lines of scholarship, perhaps also a bit simplifying. You can distinguish between two lines of scholarship. And maybe that's interesting to work on this on constitutional law. I think there is not so much on this. How do you implement a totalitarian state? Yeah? Imagine you have a person coming down to you on you and wants to be kind of little Nazi or fascist or Stalinist, and you say, as a scholar, what is a way to implement this ideology in your law? And there are two approaches which the criminal law scholars have taken. One was a radical approach, the Kiel approach, you know, the Kiel school approach. The Kiel school was a big school which included, of course, Dahm, Schaffstein, but also Karl Larenz, Karl Schmidt, you know, Methodenlehre, Karl Larenz, Canaris. And their approach was, we have to demolish the liberal law, the liberal criminal law. Things like Rechtsgut, you know, the legal interest protected, the harm principle in common law terms, in a way, and culpability, you know, proportionality, you know, things which limit criminal law, which are consequence of enlightenment, you know, which are consequence of the enlightenment field. Also in procedure, you know, of course, fair trial, right to a lawyer. You create your own judiciary. You don't rely. The Reichsgericht was at the beginning quite reluctant to accept. You had this famous trial of the von Lubbe on the fire in the Reichstag, and so the Nazis said, "Well, we cannot rely on this Reichsgericht. We create our own thing called Volksgerichtshof, you know, People's Court, you know," and so we use this for the political trials. That's, by the way, Steinbeiß's thing in this Verfassungsblock of the Third Chamber of the Constitutional Court. You know, this idea: you create your own judiciary, which is more reliable. But so demolish everything and then create a new law on the basis of the ruins of the old system and on the basis of the new socialist, national socialist ideology. That means that it is punishable if you violate the spirit of national socialism. A general offense, you know, that's enough. Metzger once said, to act against the spirit of National Socialism as such is worth to be punished. You know, this idea of something which is totally void for vagueness, you know. I mean, this is so uncertain and ambiguous, and you leave it to the judge, really, or to the police, you know, to apply this. And we don't have tripartite system on this position. And the other position, Marburg School, saying this was also a generational issue, please have some respect for our forefathers, you know. You don't just you don't just eliminate Jefferson, you know. You wouldn't do that. You know, the founders of the American Constitution, they are sacred. And in Germany, it was von Liszt and Binding and all these people who fought for liberal criminal law, Mittermeier, and then the Marburg people saying, well, we should not really be so radical. Come on, I mean, they have done some good things. Take it and fill it with Nazi contents, you know. Why? We don't need to get rid of all this. We use the legal interest, Rechtsgut, and just say the legal interest is a Nazi state. The Nazi ideology is a protection of the blood-based German Aryan community. That's it. And we don't need to be so radical to get rid of everything, to demolish everything. So these are the two approaches. In the end, it was just what I call in the book a mock battle, you know. It was a question of methodology. It was not a question of contents. The liberal lawyers and the liberal legal theorists either have left Germany, yes, we have said Kelsen, have been ousted, Richard Honig, Götting, Jewish criminal law professor, all, many of them went to the United States, and we have a lot of material from them then later. Ernst Frenkel, dual state, you know, we have all this literature by all these people who then published first in English and then later in German. Or they were killed, or they were just put into a corner, like they didn't leave. You always had these people who still stay, you know, but they have no more role, you know. Radbruch, being a minister of the Social Democrats during the Weimar Republic, of course, they were people who may not have been killed because there was a certain protection because they were too important, but they were so isolated that they had no influence. And so this is important. So not everybody, of course, was part of the Nazi movement, but many of them, the youngers especially, used it also. It's also a career opportunity. You have these opportunists, you know, opportunistic writing, you can call it, you know. You write with a new movement, you know that there's a new movement and I want to influence, I want to be a policymaker, and then I write in a certain direction because I know that's now the new idea, the new thinking which I want to support. Okay. Let's then, because time is short, go to the continuities, which I want to show you three things here, which is highly, highly shocking, actually, for Germans. I did my postdoctoral work on my habilitation, what we have in the German system, on international criminal law, and I read two books of the 40s. There is a lot of literature post-45, by Americans and by Germans, you know, and not all, of course, against Nuremberg. I mean, you have highly sophisticated literature, and one of the books was by Siegert. You remember Siegert, this Nazi? This is a book which was published in 1953. Siegert was one of the few professors who could never return to a German university because he was so charged being a Nazi who was a kind, as I said, purging Göttingen law faculty. But these people still published. And not just published on something, I mean, on anything. You could publish on church law, you know. I mean, that's maybe less problematic. But he published on Völkerstrafprozessrecht, i.e. International Criminal Procedure, Nuremberg. So this guy was not even, had not the most minimum shame not to talk about Nuremberg. He was a guy who was responsible for this, Nuremberg, you know, because of the crimes. And then he said, well, now I do an analysis of the Nuremberg Law. And it was published by our institute in Göttingen. Actually, I came much later to Göttingen, but the Göttingen Institute of International Law, which is still exists, it's a high, high renowned institute, and it was published in this series, 53. How could they have published it? So, denazification, Siegert could not return to Göttingen University, undermining, you publish stuff of Siegert. So that's, you see how it works in practice. So you cannot control, that's this idea to impose democracy, this Bush idea, this actually Bolton, now he left, thanks to God. Well, anyway, I know him from a long time ago, but these people think that they can impose on other cultures something? No, forget it, not even on the Germans, who are more, you know, obedient people. Can't do it, they still publish this Siegert. And then another guy, Dahm, again, which I mentioned, Dahm, Georg Dahm. Georg Dahm, when I read this book from 56, I did not, of course, know that Dahm was member of the Kiel school and a full Nazi. And this is an important book, historic book, on the problematic of international criminal law, also looking at the Nuremberg trials and all the problems, legality, ex post facto, whatever. But no word on the role of Mr. Dahm during the Nazi time, yes? And not in the preface saying that, by the way, I wrote some other stuff, you know, in the 30s, 36, important stuff, all in my book, about 20 writings of Dahm, which are clearly National Socialist. He was a main guy in the Kiel school, you know. So this is one thing of continuity. And you could have many, many other books in other areas. That's just maybe the climax. Then you have, what actually did these people say or not say? I mean, there was only one criminal law scholar who ever publicly admitted responsibility, and that is Schaffstein, which, by the way, is a Göttingen scholar. So one of my older colleagues knew him personally. He was more than 80. He was still around in Göttingen in the 60s, 70s. And he taught, and my first judge at the Göttingen District Court was also alumni of Göttingen, of Schaffstein. I always asked him, why was this guy? Because, no, he was a very nice old man, you know. But anyway, the writings of Schaffstein were, of course, also very important. We have no time to go into this, but believe me, look at my book, you will see everything. And Schaffstein, for example, said in one book, in an afterword, in a Nachwort, in Elscheid Herzheimer, a book, that erroneous understanding, not only in a political sense, inadmissible abbreviation of the methodological question at stake, the belief in the totalitarian ideology curtails one of the most important questions, namely how to determine the standards and criteria according to which the judge has to balance conflicting interests and values. So, Schaffstein, it was half-hearted, it was not a total admission, it was not also personal admission, you know, I made errors. He said once I made some errors, but it was never a full-fledged thing like I renounce on all this what I wrote, you know, that was never the case. But at least he said something publicly. And Dahm, who was a colleague of Schaffstein in the Kiel school, only reacted to a scholar, very important scholar, Eberhard Schmidt. Eberhard Schmidt has a big book on the history of German criminal procedure and published in Göttingen. And only when Eberhard Schmidt, in the post-45 edition, criticized Dahm and Schaffstein in an important meeting, which Wetzel from the Washington Institute, German Historical Institute in Washington, wrote about this, criticized them as being Nazis, Dahm wrote a letter to Eberhard Schmidt, a letter, a private letter, of course, it was not public, and complained and said, I do not deny the errors and mistakes to which we all more or less fell victim. I too failed to foresee the external internal developments of the National Socialist State and cherished hopes that we were bitterly dashed. But then he says, but you should not criticize, you should not be so critical of my position. We were young, and you yourself, Mr. Schmidt, you know, when you were rector of Hamburg University, made an important speech and declared your loyalty to the Nazis. And then Schmidt, in the next edition, left this part out. And the Hamburg people brought out a Festschrift of the Hamburg faculty, 100 years or 200, I don't know, where they looked at all the different scholars during 33 and 45, including Eberhard Schmidt, Moritz Formbaum, actually, who is now in Münster, the son of the other Formbaum, wrote on Eberhard Schmidt the piece. And clearly, Eberhard Schmidt had his statements in favor of the Nazis. So you shouldn't, how do you say this, right? Throw stones if you are in a glass house. So that was a problem of Eberhard Schmidt. But Dahm never went public, and Dahm then later wrote a book, second edition, 63, German Law. That is a highly ambitious book. I mean, this guy was very smart. You know, it's like the Fletcher book, American Law. I mean, how can you write on the whole law? I mean, this is terrible. This is a big thing. That's all your life. It's two lives, actually. How can you do this? The guy did it, German Law. It's an impressive book, 700-800 pages. And you look at the part on National Socialist law, at least there is a part, and he says, he shies away from judging the Nazis since it is not yet the time. In any case, National Socialism is not only the work of individuals, but also a work of history, which is why the political leaders and perpetrators somehow proves to have been led. And the personal share sings, and the share of that imposed by fate rises. You see, easy explanation. So it's not really your responsibility as an individual person, but it's a fate. But come on, I mean, these have been intellectuals, you know, these have been the elite. You know, it's scholars. It's not just, working class people. I mean, if they say we were not responsible, we were being thrown away with this movement, this was fate, you know, this was determination, we could not do anything. Who is responsible? Nobody in the end, you know. It's like saying in the United States, nobody voted for Trump. You know, if you ask them, nobody, sorry, shouldn't say this. Get it, you take this out from
me. All on there.
Yes. You shouldn't say it if you are invited, you know, that's not very nice in the House of Others, you know, say something like that. But anyway, I'm very critical of the Germans, so I could say something on the United States, you know. Anyway, so that was dumb. And then the last thing I wanted to say, that is the new right thing. In Germany, of course, there is a big deal. We have now a new right party called Alternative für Deutschland, which is in all our parliaments, which in the last election in Brandenburg and Saxony got 25%, and which is in the Bundestag. And if you look at the legal policy they do on the draft, they, of course, draft bills, you know, they put in draft bills, submit draft bills. I analyzed one. They have in part Nazi language, you know. For example, in this draft bill, I analyzed a return to NS agent-focused criminal law. This was never translated into English. But actually, the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, when they published it, put up this photo. That's from them. You see how they, the connotation, the associations of the Alternative für Deutschland. There are two wings in this party. And the idea, what we did with students in the seminar, for example, where are the continuities in German law today of Nazi ideology? And you could actually analyze the work of this party in terms of draft bills and all state legislation. We have 16 state legislations and the federal parliament. And if you analyze this, you will see a lot of Nazi talk, Nazi language, you know, burnt words, how we call them, they use in their legislative approach. The whole identitäre Bewegung, the so-called identity movement we have in Germany. We have people like you have, they call themselves Reichsbürger, you know, they say we don't accept Germany. Germany was never legally constituted. It was imposed by the Allies. The Reich, the empire still exists, and so they have their own little village, and we had a big case until the German police took this seriously when a German policeman was killed because they wanted to arrest some of these guys. They came and he shot at them, you know, and that was it because he says, here's my territory. That's the empire, you know, little empire. German law does not apply here, you know. And so, and these people now found a kind of political resource, and that is this Alternative für Deutschland. Then, of course, we have the links, historic links, and then the current links you can make on yourself. I mean, Charlottesville, the big event, you know, everybody knows Charlottesville, sorry to say, about recently out of this thing. This book, as I said, this publisher, Beck, is an absolutely important publisher in Germany, is a perhaps the most important publisher in law, transnational publisher, also in Poland he bought. And this, the history of this publisher is highly complicated because actually all German companies, you have to look at 33 and 45. When did they exist? What did they actually do? Did they, for example, buy something from Jews, okay, on low prices? Did they actually use slave labor, Thyssen, on the steel industry? And Beck has two sections. One is a literature section, two brothers, and the other is a law. And the law guy is a more conservative guy. I publish with them too, but I'm critical. I think they are very reluctant to accept responsibility. The most important German commentary on the civil code, BGB, Bürgerliches Gesetzbuch, Parland, you certainly have seen this discreet book, which every German lawyer uses, yes, which is more than 100 years old, which every German lawyer knows, and which is a money-making cow for the publisher, was initially founded by a Jew, a little Jewish publisher, as a first commentary of a German civil code, which was from 1900, and it was then bought by Beck. And it was renamed Parland because Mr. Parland was an influential Nazi bureaucrat. And now we have a campaign by students for a few years, students like you, who say, rename Poland. You know, we cannot have the name on the book still. And Beck only said, well, that's commercially not good for us. And it's totally stupid, the reaction. Not even saying in the preface of the book, the foreword, saying, who is this Poland? That's a minimum compromise thing. You can say in the foreword, well, the Poland is a bit a Nazi and so, but we still want to stick to the name. But nobody knows. And that's just what I tell you to close the circle. When I studied with Forsthoff, I did not know that Forsthoff was a Nazi. Nobody told us. Not in the preface, not in the bibliography of this book was the Nazi book of Forsthoff quoted, or in the Paland, which we don't know who is Paland. Nobody knows. So actually, Whitman certainly does not know, or I don't know, what Beck is. If he knew, he should not have published with Beck. I mean, he could publish with anybody in Germany. He's a good book. So, but. Maybe Beck is not the best choice. In this sense, for such a book, you know, where the main argument, the thrust of the argument is US immigration, race, law, and practice is a model for you, National Socialism, especially the Nuremberg laws. And looking at the Goethner Commission, when the Nazis studied US immigration, law, and practice, yes, and Freisler quoted from the practice of the United States saying, look, how do the Americans do it? Of course, we do not have blacks. Okay, we don't have this problem. But we have the Jews, you know, and we have others. And segregation is maybe too radical, you know. But we couldn't do it anyway. We are just too small. How can we do this? So we don't use segregation. So they, in some parts, even they said the Americans are too radical. But on the other hand, it was a legitimizing factor for them. They said, if the great democracy of United States does it, why can't we do it, you know, in an even more human way? So Whitman says American had things to teach Germany, an admirably uninhibited racist jurisprudence that did not trouble itself about juristic niceties and that would therefore suit us perfectly, quote Freisler. The US was a country that produced really interesting, Freisler, innovations for anybody in the business of planning a race state. Of course, this was not an unmodified borrowing. The bottom line is that the Nazis regarded American classification schemes as too harsh and the American race problem as too different for any unmodified borrowing to have taken place. Nazism is not a product made in America, but it remains the case that when the Nazis set out to build a racist order, they turned to America first to see what sort of models they could find. And then the reference to the American legal culture, and that is so interesting to further discuss maybe in seminars, is the common law more open to this kind of manipulations? You know, I mean, Whitman makes the point, the common law's flexibility and open-endedness and pragmatism as opposed to German law's legal positivism and formalism. You can say European continental law formalism, that's clear, legality formalism is French, Italian, Spanish, Portuguese law, and by legal realism. Both American legal realists and NS lawyers focus on bringing law back in line with life and social realities. Life law instead of formal law. So that's an interesting part of the book. I extend on this, explore this more in my English version. It's not so, in the German version, I did not work so much on this book. But the Whitman book is very interesting in this sense. But I stop here and these questions or comments.
I'm sure there must be lots of questions. So now is your great opportunity to ask. Because if you don't, I will. So glad to see that.
What is the awareness of this legacy today in German law schools, in students our age when they're studying German law? You know, is this taught? Is this made aware to students of this legacy?
It is not taught, and we some of us try to bring it more in. I mean, you have in the last 5-10 years, there is a greater openness, but we have not a specific course. It may be part of the legal history class. You know, you talk a bit on Nazi times, but there are some scholars who have the merit. Safferling, for example, also who is known here at part of the German Law Journal, in bringing this more to the conscience of the law schools. And there are discussions more on the level of the students, of the younger generation, I must say, in some blocks, how can we more implement this in law schools and get more awareness. That's the situation.
I'm really interested in the argument that the German, the Nazi law is part of, like, coming part of from the German tradition. So, like, how do you look at the law and say how much of it is comes from the country's tradition, culture, instead of something that completely new?
Yeah, I mean, the basic argument is that in the 19th century, in German writing and the beginning of 20th centuries, you had some writers who had an authoritarian approach to law, the idea of obedience to a norm, that is especially Binding's theory of norms, which is clearly an approach to obedience. So maybe this idea that a norm is there to be obeyed, and you don't have this kind of thing of the challenging of a norm is nothing the Germans would do as perhaps, I'm not sure, an American, or you are much more an obedient person. You have this famous novel by the brother of Thomas Mann, Heinrich Mann, Der Untertan, you know, the subordinate?
Yeah.
Translate into English.
Serf or something.
Yes. And you saw this German culture. The Germans are very obedient people, actually. I mean, maybe the migrants make us better people. It's my view. I mean, I'm very happy that we have so many migrants. Maybe not the majority opinion, but a German person, a police car comes, would slow down first thing. If police knocks on your door or rings your bell and says, "Police, open," the normal German would never ask, "What do you mean, open? I mean, can you show me your ID through the whatever? I mean, how can I know that? You don't even know that's police." So it's very, in Germany, it's very easy to make a burglary. You just go ring, "Yeah, I'm actually from police. Could you open?" "Yes, please, come in. Yes, I give you everything." So this kind of German mentality, that's clearly mentality which still exists. And only the migrants, our migrations since the 70s with the Turks and now the Arabs, makes us a more flexible society. I mean, you can judge on your own if you go to Germany. Germany has changed a lot, I think, positively. I mean, all these right people say, "No, it's terrible. All this German order and stuff, it no longer exists." But I think in this sense, German culture and German law, that of course you can say in other areas, like in criminology, social Darwinism, yes, that you judge people by their superiority, by their intellect, this racist idea of social Darwinist movements, the Scuola Positiva in Italy, Lombroso, Born Criminal, was not at all a German invention. By the way, even Jewish authors like Gustav Aschaffenburg took the position of von Liszt in the sense of their habitual offenders, the three strikes, you are out idea, the idea that there are people who you cannot correct in a system and you put them away for, lock them for the whole life, you use a death penalty. You know, this is an idea from the 19th century, it was not alone a German idea. But then this is radicalization. The Germans brought this, the Italian fascists never ever had euthanasia, for example. That was a German thing, you know, to kill even then the people. So to go so far not to exclude, put people, to deport them or whatever, but to kill them. So there are certain extremes. So the German Nazis radicalized the idea of ethnicity, of a homogeneous community, yes?
Now for his great talk. I'm sure he'd be happy to answer some more questions outside, but I know Professor Miller is about to start a class.